The used game market is going insane right now. Prices are spiking left and right. It's getting crazy. Stores are rushing to re-sticker everything, and eBay scalpers are having a field day. The Sega Saturn is my favorite console to collect for, but my god, some of this stuff is expensive as hell. I often just have to go with a Japanese copy. If you ever wanted to get a few of the good Pokemon games, have fun with that. Among the madness that is game collecting, sometimes you just want a cheap game that's a good part of your library. Everyone's talking about the best of the best on each system, but sometimes they're just too much. Shining Force, Metroid Prime Trilogy, Paper Mario Thousand Year Door, all masterpieces, at quite a steep price. What about those bargain bin games? The single digit carts and discs? Nobody wants those, right? Well, there could be something good in there. It's still a video game. There has to be some worth in it, even if it's only $5. Well, let's take a look at those games. I will be reviewing the cheapest game on every console. Before we start, let me establish a few ground rules. I'm getting my prices from PriceCharting.com. This is the best video game price resource out there, and I use it anytime I buy a game. One more thing, prices are always subject to change. If you're watching this a few months from now, there's a good chance any of these games could go up or down in price. Hell, even by the time this video comes out, they could have already fluctuated. This video has been in development longer than you think, so don't be that guy and bitch in the comments about how,
Actually, the cheapest NES game is this one. Get your facts right, Ambien.
Basically, the games covered here are most likely gonna stay in the budget bin. They've been cheap and should stay cheap. For this series not to become boring as hell, for most of the part, I'm skipping stuff like sports games, edutainment, boarding game show, that kind of stuff. And I'm also skipping games that require a separate accessory, because that's another purchase. One more thing, I'm trying to get these games physically, so I'll put the price on price charting on the screen, and then I'll tell you how much I actually paid for it. For the stuff I couldn't get my hands on, like the Fairchild Channel F, Emerson Arcadia, or Vectrex, I sadly won't be covering those. Without further ado, here is the cheapest game on every console. Kicking off the second generation, we have the Atari 2600. This console in general is cheap. It's over 40 years old and has fallen out of the spotlight. People got the nostalgia bug for it back in the late 90s to early 2000s, collected a bunch of games, and it stopped being popular as the years passed. As of recently, it's built up the reputation of being poorly aged and just plain not fun. But I still think there's worth in this console. Since no one wants them anymore, games are insanely cheap. The retro stores that still have Atari games would do anything for you to buy them. If you want to build up a library with a bunch of games that don't necessarily care about a cinematic experience, just extremely simple arcade action, the 2600 is a great choice. Here I've got Cosmic Arc from Imagic. This is a game about shooting things with a spaceship. Quite the underrepresented genre on the Atari. This game has two elements to it. Go in the mothership and shoot down the asteroids, exit the ship and abduct two creatures while avoiding the beams. Nowadays, the only reason to come back to a 2600 game is if the gameplay is still a good and unique experience. I'd call Cosmic Arc average. Even though it has two different gameplay segments, going back and forth between them gets repetitive. If it had just one great section instead of two okay sections, I think it would have been a much better time. I do enjoy the part where you control the mothership shooting the four different asteroids. It's almost like a rhythm game in a way. However, the part where you rescue the creatures is just not my favorite. Dodging the defense beams doesn't bring a fun challenge. They're just annoying with how fast they get in the later stages. This section is on a timer. Eventually, an alarm sound effect will play and you gotta hurry back to the mothership before an asteroid hits, taking you back to the first segment. This is a mechanic I enjoy because it adds a bit of franticness to beaming up the creatures. Cosmic Arc is the sequel to Atlantis, and from what I've played of it, this is the better game. But this game is still decent in terms of the 2600. Is it worth it? Yes, I had a fair share of fun with it, and for only a few dollars, you can't go wrong, especially if you want to get a set of the Imagic titles. I called about average, but you can do much, much, much worse on the Atari. It's playable, and an alright time. Magnavox Odyssey 2, one of the more forgotten Atari competitors. This console's games are a lot harder to find, but can be had for relatively cheap. Always love the design of this console. It has that 70s sci-fi appliance look to it. Throw out your gaming PCs because this thing has a keyboard too. The Odyssey 2 is kinda underrated. There aren't many compilations out there to re-experience its library. So if you're bored one day, maybe give an Odyssey 2 emulator a shot. If you have the console and need a cheap game, try Invaders from Hyperspace. I didn't get this one loose. I wanted to because I don't plan on owning an Odyssey 2, but for the video, I'm not buying any of these on eBay. In the box like this, it's worth $7.27. I paid $12. The card itself is worth $3.24. After booting up the game, I quickly found out that this one is two-player only. Miraculously, I found someone in 2021 willing to play an Odyssey 2 game with me. I did not expect to have this fun of a time. This game is bad, really bad, but that's what makes it fun. This game has aged so incredibly poorly, it's broken beyond belief. And with a buddy, it's a great time seeing what makes this game tick. The goal is to get to 10 points before your opponent does. These multicolored planets are circling, and one shot, they cycle through different colors. Player 1 is red, and player 2 is yellow, and you can take shelter on a planet of your color. After being hit, you respawn from a red or yellow planet. Confusing yet? If there are no planets out there of your color, tough shit. You have to wait for one of the UFOs to shoot a planet, and hopefully it becomes red or yellow. Otherwise, you're just gonna be staring at the screen, waiting for the opportunity to play the video game you just bought. You can tell they wanted to add depth into this game, but it's 1979, and the execution is so unbelievably poor. You can spend minutes just waiting to be able to keep playing because of the planet color RNG. The UFOs are also extremely bullshit. After respawning, you can instantly crash into one, and not have the chance to respawn and have to wait all over again. Plus, their shots are very accurate. It's hard to hit these guys. When playing this game, it feels like you're constantly dying over and over, and it's hard to not laugh at that. The UFO AI is so jittery and dumb, which also adds to the ironic enjoyment of this game. Each round taught us a new quirk of this title, and we experimented with how bad we could break the game. And when you win, this game gives you a seizure. You see, back in the 70s, they didn't have graphics, but they sure did have colors, and they loved to use them. I did not expect to have a good time like this. However, in the future, the novelty could wear off after playing too much. I found this game to be a lot of fun, but not in the traditional sense. Is it worth the money? Well, it depends. If you can get this ironic enjoyment out of it, as I did, then yes, it is worth it. But if you don't have someone to make fun of this game with, you should pass. This is not going to make me want to get an Odyssey 2, but I had some fun inside the emulator. Intellivision. Unlike the Odyssey 2, I did intend to get this game in the box. See, the Intellivision had a phone controller, and the games came with overlays. Boxed Intellivision games are more common than you would think. Intellivision owners took good care of their games. 40 years later, these are still in decent shape. I don't see Intellivision games everywhere, but if you have a store or two near you that stocks them, it's not a bad choice for collecting. I have Night Stalker here in the box. Yes, collecting games like this is going to be more expensive, but if I have the option, I like to go for that. In the box, it's worth 10 bucks, and I got it for that exact price. And loose, it's only $1.20. Night Stalker is kind of like a horror game. It has this droning thumping sound that makes things more intense. The background looks like a haunted house. The goal here is to shoot the robot. He can also shoot, and mastering dodge timing is how you get good. I found the controls to be rather clunky, but if you're playing on a real Intellivision, they are quite a bit worse. Using the number pad, you can fire in four different directions. This I don't have a problem with, but moving your character is just not precise at all. Turning corners is not that accurate. Running into the robot will kill you, but if you run into the bats, they just make you go through this falling animation. I do think the animations in this game are pretty cool. The player's running looks very smooth, and blowing up the robots is satisfying. Up in the top left corner is a spider web, and bullets don't travel through here. Once you figure out the map and get a hang of things, the game quickly becomes way too easy. I mean, come on. You can just sit here and keep spawn camping the robot. Every 6 shots, you gotta collect a new gun, but that isn't much of a hassle, so you pretty much sit there and rack up points. Eventually, a new robot spawns, and he's much harder and faster. If you gotta reload, he'll chase after you, and he makes the game just slightly more challenging. After you keep racking up points on him, eventually a bunch more robots will spawn. This is when the game gets good. Since there are 3 of them, you can't just kill them as they respawn. I had some genuine fun once I got to this point, but it does take a little bit. Once you get good at it, it isn't too long, but it is annoying having to go through the boring segment of the game over and over. Night Stalker is actually okay. I own 4 copies. Maybe I should explain? A few years ago, my dad ordered an Intellivision console bundle off of eBay, and since Night Stalker is so common, it came with 3 copies of it along with all these games. For this video, I have to go out and buy these games, so yeah. I have yet another copy of Night Stalker in my house. Cool. Is Night Stalker worth owning? It depends. Complete in box, there are 1,000 better ways to spend 10 bucks in my opinion. But if you can deal with a loose cart, it's not a bad purchase. If you ever meet me at a convention and mention Night Stalker, I will gladly give you one of my 4 copies. It's my pleasure. ColecoVision. I never really cared about this system much, but honestly, I think it might be the best of this generation. The ColecoVision had great arcade ports like Sega and Nintendo stuff, and I think the graphics are better than the Intellivision and the 2600. Library seems to be more focused on quality over quantity. It also has some cool accessories, probably most infamously, the Expansion Module 1. It allows you to play Atari carts on your ColecoVision. This sure as hell can't be legal today. Unlike the Intellivision, you can unplug the phone controllers and swap them for something more comfortable. The ColecoVision rocks, and I'd like to get one someday. But for now, I have two cartridges for this console, Carnival and Zaxxon. The former is the cheapest, so I'm gonna review it. Carnival is worth $4.25, and I paid $3.95 for it. It's a Sega arcade game. This is gonna be good. Ah, well, they just published it. It was developed by Gremlin. Still, the ColecoVision did great arcade ports, so this one could be good too. Whoa, look at that. It's very arcade accurate. This is a sharpshooting game, and I have no clue what any of this crap means. This game isn't too pick-up-and-play friendly. In my first game, I was quite confused and frustrated. After a few rounds, things start to make a little sense. You only have so many bullets, and accuracy is key. You also don't want to let the ducks reach the bottom of the screen, or else they'll fly down and eat your bullets. That means these are live animals instead of cut-out targets. What a carnival. Bonus leathers should also be shot along with these squares, which can give you more ammo. Eventually, I got stuck. I shot everything. What's next? Well, you also have to line yourself up with the edge of whatever this is and shoot the pipes. By the time I figured this out, the ducks were being produced at an incredible rate and I couldn't keep up. It took several game overs for me to figure this out, and it was honestly a stressful time. Tons of my shots grazed past the animals, and whenever you're low on ammo, it's frustrating as hell. However, once you figure out this game, it's not the worst. Yeah, it can feel like Space Invaders Wannabe number 1000, but the music and graphics are charming, so that's a bit of a redeeming quality. The carnival theming is great, but I can't recommend this game. It was too generic. Carnival is mediocre and boring, and I'm not sure if it's worth buying. I bet it's a person-by-person thing. If you have a ColecoVision and think this game is worth owning, then you're probably right. But if you don't think you'd enjoy this one, then you're gonna be right on that one too. The Atari 5200, the infamously horrible console, garbage controller, and games that are just a slight improvement over the 2600. I think it's better than most people say, but that certainly doesn't make it a great console. There's fun to be had, but on real hardware, it looks like a huge hassle. So I'm probably never gonna get one of these. The cheapest game on here is Pac-Man. It's worth $3.34, and I paid $3.95. Everyone knows how horrendous 2600 Pac-Man is, so let's find out if the 5200 can do better. It's quite the low bar, but at the same time, it's the 5200, so my expectations are below zero. This is not that bad at all. Yes, of course the arcade version is much better, but as far as a port goes, this is serviceable. What's there really to say? It's a decent way to play Pac-Man. Yes, there are a plethora of other ways to play this arcade classic, but this one is by no means a bad one. For only a few bucks, this is without a doubt a great purchase for your library. I wish I had more to talk about, but there's nothing else to it. You already know everything about Pac-Man, and this is just another okay way to play it. Just make sure you get a good controller, or else playing this will be incredibly unfun. So yeah, Pac-Man on the 5200 is a surprisingly great game. Nintendo Entertainment System. This console needs no introduction. It's the Nintendo. You already know quite a bit about it and have most likely played at least one of its games. The cheapest game on price charting is quite the infamous one, Top Gun. Worth $1.61, I paid $2.95. Now, why is this game so infamous? Well, it's one of the Angry Video Game Nerd's most well-known reviews. Chances are, if you're watching retro game content, you've at least seen one of his videos. And that means this game is pretty bad, right? Well, it's actually pretty good. No, it sucks. This is a combat flight simulator on the NES. So, of course, it has aged horribly. It's hard to figure out what exactly you're supposed to do, especially for those landing sequences. They are brutally difficult and are frustrating as hell. The main bulk of this game is shooting down the planes in the sky. This is just flat out boring. You don't feel a sense of accomplishment for landing hits. Some of the planes will also fire out missiles, which you pretty much have to shoot down or else they will, without a doubt, hit you. There's no excitement to it, and playing it for a while can feel like a chore. The Combat Flight Simulator wasn't really done right until Afterburner came out. That game gives the player a sense of speed with many more enemy planes flying past and moving backgrounds. It has a certain spectacle to it that Top Gun just doesn't. It's not the fairest comparison since Afterburner ran on Sega Superscalar hardware, but it shows that the NES just isn't up to games like this. Top Gun could have been great, but I feel like that it was just a little bit too ahead of its time. You can tell there was ambition, but the execution of it just all fell flat. What we have is a bland and frustrating game that you'll play once and not ever want to again. I don't think this game was worth it. The only reason you buy it is if you're either a huge fan of the nerd or the movie. Other than that, give this one a pass. The Sega Master System. This console is seriously underrated. People just pass it off as a lame Alex Kidd playing Nintendo ripoff, but it's so much more than that. One, I love Alex Kidd, and two, the library is high quality. The games are super colorful, and the FM sound module makes for some excellent soundtracks. For the roughly 300 or so titles, many of them are a great time. Sega made the smart decision of packaging their Master System games in these hard clamshell cases. This means that the boxes weren't thrown away all that much, and manuals also stayed intact more easily. This is the same case for most of the Genesis library, but towards the end of its life, they did switch to cardboard. I love collecting for these systems. Owning these games in a nice box and also having the manual makes each purchase feel more substantial. Sega did what Nintendo should've. The cheapest game here was the pack-in title, Hang On and Safari Hunt. I said I was excluding sports games, but this is an exception. Sega Racers are fantastic, and it's a 2-in-1 cart. Now that's what I call a deal, except I didn't get a deal. This game is worth $6.87, like this in the box, and I paid $12.95. Yikes. To be fair, it came in pretty good condition and had a poster, so I'd say it's worth a little bit more than $6.87. Still, not my finest purchase. I went on eBay to see the sold listings because who knows, price charting could be wrong, and yep, you can get this game in the box for around 7 to 10 bucks. Unless you're this absolute buffoon who paid $50. Now I feel a lot less bad. I'm getting way off topic, so enough of that. Review time. Hang On was originally in the arcades in July of 1985. It's one of the earliest 16-bit video games and is a joy to play. Developed by the legendary Yu Suzuki, this isn't Sega's first time making a racing game, but it's the earliest one most people know about. Sega arcade racers are fantastic, and Hang On is no exception. So how'd they do porting a 16-bit game to 8-bit hardware? Unlike Fantasy Zone, this game has sprite scaling, which would be harder to replicate. Well, this is actually pretty good. It scrolls fast and smooth, just like the arcade. Of course, there's a lot of lost detail, and sadly the background music is only on the title screen, but as far as gameplay goes, this is great. Hang On was the predecessor to OutRun and has the same gameplay formula. Race against the clock and make it to the checkpoints while dodging obstacles as fast as you can. Simple, but it's just excellent. The classic Sega arcade racers are all masterpieces in their own right, and Hang On is fantastic. I was a little worried about the controls. If you've seen the arcade machine, it's analog steering, and the deluxe sit-down model is controlled by a fake bike. Well, with only a D-pad, it might seem tough to have it control well. Thankfully, this is not the case. It's smooth and not too sensitive. Changing the gears is done with the up and down, and that works well too. This game is insanely replayable. It just hooks you in, and you'll want to keep giving it just one more try over and over. It is a classic Sega title in every sense of the word, and I love it so much. But that's only half the story. What about Safari Hunt? Well, this is a light gun game, so I'm gonna have to film my CRT. I couldn't figure out how to change the refresh rate on my camera, so you're just gonna have to bear with me here. Grab your Sega Light Phaser, cause it's shooting time. This game is basically Sega's version of Duck Hunt. It's just as good, if not better. In Duck Hunt, you shoot two ducks. Here, there are three different levels and several different animals to fire at on each location. Can we just take a moment to appreciate the Sega Light Phaser? Look at that design, it's so badass. They did make this the gun in Zillion, a very cool sci-fi anime from the 80s, and it sure does fit that description. Cool 80s sci-fi blaster. Plus, the accuracy in this game is great. I found this to work a lot better than Duck Hunt. The cartridge is worth it for Hang On alone, but you also get a fantastic light gun game for whenever you obtain a light phaser. Hang On and Safari Hunt was an excellent launch title then, and today, it's still an excellent purchase. Two fantastic games in a nice hard case for only about $6. Talk about value. This is the game that inspired me to make this series. The bargain bin games have a bit of a stigma around them, but as it turns out, there can be some hidden gems in there. If you have a way to play Master System games, whether that be a power-based converter or original console, this game is essential to a collection. Atari 7800. Not as bad as the 5200, but it still isn't the greatest. I'm sure it has its fans, but I could never get into it myself. I'd pick one up for a good deal, considering it has 2600 backwards compatibility, and I love a good game of Food Fight, but there isn't too much compelling me to get one of these. Unlike the Master System, this is weaker than the competition. It was supposed to release in 1984, but got canned and came out in 1986. It uses the same exact sound chip of the original Atari from 1977. Compared to the NES and Master System, things just sound horrible. There wasn't much of a reason to buy one of these back then, and there still isn't 35 years later. But to the small group of owners out there, is Xevious worth it? I paid $7.95 when it was only worth $5.95, but it was the only place I could find it. Personally, I'm fine with paying just a little over price charting if that means I'm getting it at a local store. Xevious is the other shmup from Namco, the one that isn't Galaga. It's a great challenging game, and its main claim to fame is its firing mechanic. You can fire at enemies in the air, or drop a bomb to hit ones on the ground. To my surprise, this is a great port. I expected this to have crappy graphics and ear-bleeding sound, but no, it has none of those. The graphics, while a bit undersaturated, work, and the scrolling is smooth. The 7800 is infamous for its awful sound, but this does a great job at replicating the arcade. I do have one issue with it. Despite there being two buttons on the 7800, the fire button shoots both air and ground at the same time. I prefer it separately. Xevious is a fun and challenging shmup that a lot of people love. Namco museums are a lot easier to get hold of than a 7800, and this game makes a majority of the compilations, so that's gonna be the better way to play. But if you're a fan of the 7800, this makes a great game to show people the value of the console. Yet again, we have a game that I think is worth it. So, that was the cheapest game on every second and third gen console. Quite the surprise if I do say so myself. You'd expect these to be the most bottom of the barrel, low budget shovelware titles, but actually, there's a lot of fun to be had here. These games don't get all that much attention and are great starting points for building up a library. When starting your collection, it's great to find games that have value to you, but not to the general market. It's one of the many joys of game collecting to find a game that just clicks with you for a pretty good price. Before I wrap this up, I'd like to give a shout out to all the independent video game stores out there. I'm in the Northeast Ohio area, and we have some incredible people here in the retro scene. If you're ever up here, be sure to check out James Games. I love this place, and they have a fantastic selection of all things Sega. I got my Saturn here, so you know it's special. Also, go to Video Game Connection. They've been around for nearly 30 years, and have a bunch of stuff for almost every console. If you take the drive down to Columbus, you can go to Warp Zone. They have an incredible selection of import stuff. I could go on and on about all the fantastic stores in this state, but I'll keep it brief and end it here. Thank you all for keeping this fantastic community alive. And to the viewers of this video, support a small business and take a trip down to one of your local retro game stores. Well, that's about it for today. I'm AmiBen, and I'll catch you later.